right now. We are going to jump into the second match. Thanks guys for the follow. We have Misha, we have Stormy Sanchez, we have Vurelius. Welcome, welcome. And yeah, let's focus right now on the match, guys. I will talk with you a little bit later. Yes, Koshpar, only two teams. Okay, so Bondguard. They have won their first defense game. Let's see if they will be able to do something like that once more, this time on the attack. They are bringing in once more a lot of light and medium armor sticks. So I believe this is the same. And the same setup with spears, muskets, longbow, shortbow. On the other end, Endgegner, we can see they are bringing in 5 medium and light armors in total. 2 spears, 2 muskets, and 1 shortbow. So I believe this is quite similar. One big difference is that Pondguard right now being in offense, they are bringing much less hammers, much less mauls, and we'll see where it goes. When it comes to the units, a lot of purple units chosen on both ends. It makes sense. Defenders, of course, with Zikalian Militia, very nice. And once more, Endgegner quite heavy on the cavalry side. Pondguard bringing in only 2 cavalry units once more. So very similar play style when it comes to units. We can see just 3, I believe, yes, 3 Namkan units. I seen like 1 or 2 Zikalian Militia on Pondguard. So quite, I would say quite limited in their options, right? They have a lot of pikes, shields, halabards, yes, great, but not that many cavalry, not that many flanking opportunities. Not that much arquebuses or archers, meaning not that much damage output in the long run. So we will see if this will be something that will be problematic for them at the end. And Endgegner in the units department, they are definitely much more balanced, bringing a lot of different units, more Zikalian Militia for the defenders. I mean, in the attacking side, also Endgegner had like 2 or 3 Zikalian Militia, so very nice usage of these units we have seen in this tournament and from Endgegner team as well. But yeah, let's focus right now on what is happening. Standard opening, everyone using artillery. Short reminder that in this tournament you cannot place any artillery. Only artillery you can use is what is already on the map. And second thing is for attackers is trebuchets pretty much, right? So that's it. And we can see, yeah, some Hvachas cleaning down this village watchman for whatever reason. Probably they didn't have, yes. So Hvacha did not have yet the angle for shooting at tower. Right now it's focusing on tower. Okay, that makes absolute sense. And we can see 3 towers being pushed right now by Bondguard. We can see CB, my fellow co-caster, right now trying to create some pressure on the side, bringing attention of 3 Endgegner players. So very well played. Good highlight for my guy over here, running on his horse majestically, very nicely. And yeah, trebuchets cleaning up more artillery. And there is a big difference I can notice. Can you notice it as well compared to the previous games? The towers are moving forward. Yes, they are very low HP. We can see this tower is like 20%. Middle tower, half. Left tower is going to die in a moment, probably. Will it die though? They don't. It will, okay. They were shooting with Magner with shortbow. But yeah, Endgegner, much worse job with tower destruction. We've seen Pondguard destroyed each tower at least once, and some of them I believe even twice, if I recall correctly. So very well done on the tower department. Here for Pondguard in attack, bringing in middle tower, and this one also I believe will reach last. Oh, look at this, no HP, it's like 0 HP. What the nice, very nicely played. 0 HP, but 2 towers are there, so no time lost, no single second lost from Pondguard, and they are going to bring a push here. So we can see a very different approach to the defense from Endgegner. They are going to fight Pondguard here on the tower. They are blocking them from both ways, having some players on left, some players on right, and trebuchets are flanking. This is what Pondguard wanted to not have. trebuchets on their face. That's why they decided like that previously to not do it. This time, Endgegner aggressively defending, pushing forward. Very nice usage of Zikalian militia. Look at that fire everywhere, burning all the units. But this is going to be cleaned with one more trebuchet and very good advance from Pond Guard. Namkans had to move, not too many died, that's great, but still quite a lot of units lost, and seems like the point will be captured. Two players here hiding with their units behind the cap zone. They were planning to make stop capture of the A point as much as they can, but unfortunately Pond Guard very massively moved in and cleared them out. Are they going to cap it? No. Rabelais and Sustov are very close. Two heavy armors going to block it for as much time as they can. One more short sword. High novelty close by. Gitas as well. Sorry, Taz as well. Dr. Drgo as well. So a lot of players from Endgegner playing very aggressively here on the defense. And this pays off. Not too many units are there for the Pond Guard left. Meaning that Endgegner can just run around the point and survive quite long. And the trebuchets that right now Pond Guard are using, they are not that effective. They are not killing that many units. They are not killing that many heroes. So very, very well played. Different approach, but also well played from Endgegner. We can see Takeno as well blocking in. And yes, it will be captured. Unfortunately, he was picked out from the point by Petudi. So the point A was captured by the Pond Guard. And right now, let's see, only 8 Endgegner players alive. So if Pond Guard will notice this, they can try and rush the plus point. And it seems like they are going to try to do it. They have just few units, unfortunately, in the attack. And the defenders on the other end, yes, they don't have too many units either. They have just one shield unit and two pikes, one halabard, yes, and some Zikalia militia hidden behind. And seems like Pond Guard noticed that they already prepared their defense and they switched around, moved to another plus point. They are going to focus on killing heroes. One problem, and let's look at the stats right now, what might be in the long run for Endgegner is that they already lost quite a few lives. As you can see, eight players only died from Pond Guard, but 14 players died from Endgegner so far. 14 lives. There is limited amount of lives you have. You have only 3 lives per player, and we can see that already Papu, one left, so his last life is there, so he will really, really, really need to watch out on what he's doing. In terms of units, this is also interesting. 1,100 in Pond Guard and only 900 for the Endgegner. Most of this difference is coming from the cavalry, because on units loss we can see it's quite similar. Endgegner having much more cavalry, they cannot have that many units in terms of unit count. Right now we can see advance after advance after advance coming here in the middle from Pond Guard. They are trying to make their ground. Trilling here from behind with his counter advance. We can see as well some horses from Endgegner already moving around, and the timing for the horses is quite good because most of the advances are already done. Unfortunately, yeah, he lost most of the horses for the Forte Braces, so he tried to do it as good as he could, but didn't manage to do so. And Pond Guard, look at that. They managed to win the fight in the middle. Very well placed pikes, very well staggered advances, not all at the same time. Nice cavalry, not too many because they bring 2 in total to the game. And only one was used in this action, but so scarce cavalry, but very well used. I see some questions. Yes, this is the second game, and the first one, Pond Guard was victorious in defense. So they successfully defended the fort, even though Endgegner was quite close and they captured around 70% of the last cap zone. So very, very well played from both teams. Right now, what we can see is Endgegner trying to put a defense in the standard spot. They have also Kenepawa here watching the flank. We can see Takeno with horses also covering the flank, and Trilling also horses waiting on the flank to see what happens. Pond Guard right now rotating heavily to bring as many units as they can to the front line. and they are going to harass a little bit the units in the front for a Gegner. Opening trebuchets, I don't think it will hit at all, maybe a little bit, but we'll see in a moment. Looking at the statistics before the last fight, 1000 units left for Pond Guard, 600 lost, 800 left for Endgegner, 530 lost, so similar numbers. When it comes to lives of the players, 18 lives lost on Endgegner, only 10 lost on Pond Guard. We don't have a single person who died twice on Pond Guard. We have already 3 people on Endgegner who are on their last life, so they need to watch out. And the attack is being prepared very heavy in the shields and pikes department. So seems like Pond Guard want to do something similar what Nexus did in the group A. They wanted to go full brawl, no ranged units, not too many supporting units, just full on horse advances, pikes, shields, you know, brute force, brute strength. This is going to be interesting when compared to Endgegner, who currently have on the field one Zykalian militia, so they are going to harass a little bit, and one Namkan Ersch. And the push is here. Push is here. We can see Guard coming in very far wide to try to flank out Endgegner. Endgegner counter rotating very nicely. This trebuch not hitting anything, unfortunately. And we can see a clash of the titans here in the middle. Both teams are advancing. Look at this advance from Pond Guard. They are kicking everyone down. We can see some cavalry coming as well from behind, trying to cover this flank. But yeah, seems like the amount of forte braces that Endgegner had on the field was just perfect, because they managed to hold down quite a lot of Pond Guard offense. Unfortunately, this trebuch will be quite crucial, cleaning down a lot of the units that are left, and cavalry coming in very strong after all the advances were finished, after all the pikes were dead, they just cleaned up the house, as you might say. Right now, Endgegner, double horse coming from behind, we'll see if they will be able to make it in time and try to help the main point from dying. 12 versus 8 heroes right now on the battlefield, so much more players alive for Pond Guard. Unfortunately, they don't have too many units left. And Gegner, if you guys play this well with the horses, seems like you will be able to clear this out. All the units pretty much from Pond Guard are down. And Gegner right now cleaning up the house. Look at that. Capture point is just slightly captured, is like 5% or even less, and a lot of people are dying right now from Pond Guard running for their lives. Very well executed with the cavalry. I am actually quite amazed on how Pond Guard did this, let this happen. They did not cover their back too well, and this cavalry in the back tactic is something which is very often happening on either sieges or on ranked place. So yeah, right now Endgegner, as Endgegner do, very aggressively playing forward, trying to take as much time as they can from the Pond Guard, and pressuring also their plus point, not allowing people who are alive to exchange their units, also creating pressure here on the gate, trying to clear units out from the people that are coming in to the battlefield. And this is something that is nice to see, because the unit count is quite similar right now. You can see 490 versus 400, so very similar. Heroes killed. This is something that's right now very interesting. Seems like Endgegner did overdo it. They took the plus point. Congratulations, but you lost all your players on the main point. And this is very problematic right now, because we can see 1, 2, 3 players from Endgegner already died 3 times, meaning they cannot respawn anymore. So Endgegner, 12 players max. Right now CB and Easy Peasy Baby rushing into the cap point, cleaning down, trying to clean down remaining units. Yes, they still have 4 trebuchets left, so they are trying to use it well. And Gegner right now rotating back and trying to defend it. They noticed, they did not notice the trebuchets, unfortunately, and many of the fortebraches died. What's fortunate is that this barricade is indestructible here, meaning that Pond Guard, they cannot just run through the middle to the camp point, they have to go to either side. And right now, Trilling still in behind with his spear, with his horses, going to create a lot of pressure. We can see Mastiff here with novelty as well, coming in with Condottieris, creating pressure from behind. Gavinio also from the front with Dr. Drko, very well cut for all the supplies. Pontgard, they are having different approach. They are moving most of their forces together here, as you can see, trying to just go through the wall of Endgegner, moving slowly but surely towards the cap. Not too many units left on either side, 300 versus 200. Trilling coming into suppress with his cavalry, all these Pontgard players. We'll see if he'll be successful. For now, he's just waiting. And yeah, Pontgard able to clean out many of the Endgegner players, and only two are alive. If you look at the statistics, you can see on the right side, everyone from Endgegner who have three lives left cannot spawn anymore. They have six spawns only left and zero players right now alive on the field. So yeah, it's done, I'm afraid. The enemy is about to capture the final. My guys, we have noticed something that I thought cannot be done. Pontgard have managed to win this attack and managed to capture the fort successfully on the attack side. Holy moly. What an intensive game. Take a look at the stats. I need to take a short break because my dog is doing something strange. Stop the camera. Okay. Sorry for that minute of silence, but we can give this minute of silence to Endgegner, I guess, who unfortunately lost both their games. Congratulations to Pontgard for winning both on defense and attack. Let's take a quick look at the statistics. From Pontgard, we can see three people over 100 units in form of CB. Congratulations, Toad King and Giotto. So very well played. On the other end, we can see Trilling, yeah, spear player, 10 kills. Solo handedly, of course, with his Armingers, he killed 200 units and 10 heroes. Guys, you have 3 lives only in this tournament. So this means each team have 45 spawn points total. He took 10 out of Pontgard. Amazing, amazingly played. We can see also quite a lot of unit kills on many of the Endgegner players. Considerably, 6 of them had over 100 and 1 of them over 200. So very different. This comes from the very different approach to the units, I guess. We've seen that Pontgard bring in, at the start of the game, they had much more units because they bring in pikes or units which had who have a lot of people in the squad, so that's where this numbers difference comes from. But yeah, very interesting. And then yeah, Giotto, 12 kills. Come on, guys, what's happening here? He yeah, 3 more kills and he would kill the whole team. Right, so that's amazing stats. But yeah, also like, there is only 2 or 3 players on Pontgard who have not killed a single player, so very well played, very well balanced statistics all around the way. And yeah, that's all for the stats, I guess. When it comes to the post-battle analysis, this game was pretty much from first second very interesting and actually was very full of all the action. So in point A, Endgegner defended, right? They lost a lot of units to trebuchets, unfortunately. Endgegner didn't also manage to destroy 2 towers, so Pontgard were able to get up with 2 towers from the start of the game. But this allowed us to observe very heavy fights across whole walls around A point. So Endgegner team, they very well played with their heroes. They hidden even 2 of their heroes with some of the units behind the cap point. And when Pontgard thought that the A is clear, they moved away, right? They come out from their hiding and they build a lot of units from behind. So very interesting tactics as well there from Endgegner, but definitely they were offensive and aggressive since first moment, and this was seen on the wall. A lot of units were dying at that point. So you can see here a lot of 3 minute mark, a lot of things happened. Then after that, pawn guard went down. There were a lot of fights in the middle, and at the end they managed to retake the plus point, move towards the cap zone, and a lot of fighting was happening in the cap zone. We have seen this many units died and many heroes that died over there in this one of the final pushes. After that, Endgegner very aggressively pushed away Pontgard back to their spawn, killed a lot of units, a lot of heroes there, but Pontgard managed to stick together with few of their heroes and pushed it to the end. So congratulations to the Pontgard team for winning both games. And yeah, welcome back, CB.
Yeah, thank you.
How did you like it?
Yeah, this was so much fun. This was amazing. I love it's so fun to see how they communicate within the team as well. Like, it's pretty on point, man. You can tell why they are a good team.
Cool. Yeah, so if you have not noticed, unfortunately CB was not here for the games because Pond Guard unfortunately had two players who couldn't make it to the tournament. So both CB and German co-caster Samuel, they were invited to join Pontgard, and thanks to that we had balanced 15 versus 15 match. Of course, Endgegner, they said that they can, you know, kick some of their players from the squad and make it even, you know, 13 versus 13 or whatever, but thanks to the help of co-casters we had even 15 versus 15 games. Very well played. And yeah, CB, what did you think about the games?
Yeah, it was interesting. Like what we talked about before the game, Pontgard definitely expected, of course, the Zekalia militia to come in from Endgegner. And I think you could tell that Endgegner expected Kev, right? Because they were, in the first game, they were really hesitant on pushing the towers. So it took a few minutes before we finally got hit with the siege towers, and yeah, that gave us a lot of time to talk about the strategy and stuff. So I think that was pretty interesting to see. And I think in the first game, the Kev rush for Endgegner was so interesting, right? I hope you had fun with that on stream, mm-hmm. because it caught us by surprise on the Pontgard team. But yeah, that was great, amazing to see. And then Endgegner got a great defense as well with the army guard in the back. Pontgard did expect that. They put up some Fort Brachios. Mm-hmm. But Endgegner still managed to get the great Arminger defense on the final. So yeah, I think those two games were really interesting.
Yeah, yeah.
How was it on your side?
Much harder to comment alone. I got used to doing the co-commenting, so yeah. That's a bummer, but I tried to do my best. I had to drink much more water between the games, but yeah, I mean, very interesting games compared to what we have seen last week, where both teams I mean, I would say that these teams today and last week, the teams were quite equal in terms of strength, but the tactics and strategy, what they have chosen, that's totally different. Last week, what we have seen is similar tactics and similar like strategy. Yes, the unit choice was a little bit different here and there, some decisions and so on. But generally speaking, the clashes and the fights were similar. Over here, like the first push of Endgegner, like from your perspective, was it like, or how did you react when they all popped up in behind in your like cap with all the horses?
In the second game, you mean?
No, the first game when Endgegner was attacking and they popped up in your cap,
yeah,
like exactly. Behind the.
So we saw them coming on the left side. Of course, they were coming over there with infantry, and then we noticed that they were gone. So we realized, okay, they're moving over. So already some guys started to move over there, mm-hmm. and then they were like, okay, they're coming through the gates with Kev, and they're rushing us. So it was really quick that they said, okay, we all go to the other supply set up there. And then we did get surprised that they even wanted to go for the final. So we didn't see that coming. Mm-hmm. I hope you got it on stream, but I threw some Zekalia militia fireballs Yes. Stopped a couple of cav. I was really proud of that. So yeah, that push was definitely surprising and how far Endgegner wanted to go for the final camp, I think.
Yeah, and they were quite close, right? I mean, of course, Pontgard have reacted quite nicely with the rotation, but unit difference, right? Pontgard having mainly infantry, the amount of distance they had to walk was quite considerable, and this allowed Endgegner to outrun them with the cavalry. And the first moments of the cap point, of the main point, what we have seen was like one or two Pontgard players with just units, with just heroes, versus like two or three Endgegner players with heroes and units. So this could go very hard, very fast, right? Very, very problematic. If you know, some of the trebuchets from Endgegner would land a tiny bit more accurately or something like that, and could cut off the supplies, this could be totally different fight. But yeah, very interesting. And then after that, the push, you know, if we'll be able to talk with the teams after the deathmatch, friendly deathmatch, you will see in a moment. If we'll be able to talk with the teams, I want to ask Endgegner if this is what they planned, and this was more of a distraction, because after that they immediately jumped down to the right side, this closer to the wall, plus captured it, quickly rearranged their units and moved to the final point with the heavy push, right? So this was very nicely executed. But we can talk about this and the second game in a moment, as we are jumping right now to the deathmatch, so good luck.